country that brought the world pub grub, ploughman's lunches and pork pies comes some classic dishes and marvellous traditions. Welcome to the delicious, intricate and amusing world of English cuisine.
Yeah, exactly.
Join our food safari to learn how to make the adored roast beef and Yorkshire pudding, the delights and dictums of afternoon tea, the secrets of the perfect fish and chips, roll mops and pickles, and the delicious simplicity of a glorious summer pudding.
The very, very simple side of it is tradition. Tradition, honesty, and the fact that we don't waste anything. It's the most diverse, and it's got so many things going on for us. Using different ingredients and spices and techniques, and the more you look into it, the more history and the more knowledge you find about English cuisine, it just gets better and better.
46, pig is one, mullet is two, flowers are five. 46, go.
Matthew Kemp was brought up on Canvey Island, Essex, and knew he wanted to be a chef from the age of 11. His passion is what he calls the secondary cuts of meat, which he says are very peasanty and very British, and often on the menu of his two Sydney restaurants, Balzac and Burlington.
You know, if you go back in history, it's all like the affluent have always got the really, really nice, beautiful cuts like we're looking at here.
Yeah.
You know, and sort of all our peasants is what was left over. Just showing what, you know, what can be brought out of flavours, you know, out of ears and cheeks and noses and tongues and tails, which are absolutely gorgeous if you actually know what you're doing with them. You know, you're not going to put them on at like 12 o'clock to eat them at 1. Mm. You know, you're putting them on a Friday and then you're having them for Sunday lunch, you know, because it does take that little while to get there. Mm. You get more flavour out of it. When we hit winter and it's like, you know, 4 or 5 degrees outside, that English traditional food, everyone's just sitting going, yeah, give it to me, you know. I want some braised shanks, I want some oxtail, something that's been cooked for 5 hours with loads of mash, you know. Really just hearting, comforting. You want to go and sit on an armchair in front of the fire, you know, afterwards and just start, you know, zonk out, you know, front of watching Arsenal win, hopefully, you know. It's not exactly a sun-blessed country, is it? You know, let's be honest, right? A lot of the food and the cuisine and the dishes dictate the fact vegetables that can grow in cooler climate, you know? Yeah. Like lots of the root vegetables, cabbage.
Yep.
You know, cauliflowers, Brussels, spuds, obviously, you know,
yeah,
no
so
spuds.
Potatoes,
yeah, forget about it, yeah.
Yeah.
We didn't have chips, and I think the English society would be, you know, stopped.
So when does an Englishman eat cheese?
Oh, well, any time, but always, you know, our lunch with our ploughman's lunch, you know, a big hunk of cheddar, a roll, you know, Branston pickle, a big pile of, like, you know, pickled onions, and away you go, you know, that and a pint of ale, you just can't beat it. It's fantastic. And we look at our Stilton we've got here, I mean, God, how long has this been
serious,
around? You know, this is it, you know. This really is an absolutely fantastic Stilton. Yeah. Beautiful, beautiful cheeses. There's just so many different diversities, you know. The white molds, the washed rinds, the goat cheeses, you know, the sheep's milk. There's so many varieties. It's just out of this world.
So you reckon you give the French a good running on the cheese?
Oh, leave it for dust. Leave it for dust. We've got flounder here, but over there we've got like, you know, 10 or 12 different types of those sort of fish. So there's some beautiful, beautiful stuff there. You know, our oysters are out of this world. Mm. And the streams as well, you know, you go out there for wild salmon and beautiful rainbow trout, you know.
And cockles and mussels, I guess.
Oh, yeah, alive-o and all that.
Yeah. But fish and chips, is that the great English takeaway?
Well, yes, I mean, in England, you know, you've got to have what type of fish you're going to have with your chips. I mean, like down south, it's rock cod, right? It's like, you know, you go north and it's always, it seems to be haddock.
Yeah.
So that's what's actually in that area is what sort of like the regionality of what's in your fish and chips, you know?
And
so
fish and chips did start in England.
Oh, I hope so.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm not going to let it go anywhere else.
Fish and chips is a tradition that's spread throughout the English-speaking world. Fish cooked in batter that was the cheap bycatch from the North Sea fishermen who started using trawling nets in the mid-19th century. Potatoes were plentiful and cheap, the magic combination sold in chippies or chippers in every English town.
Coming from Liverpool, it was a big Catholic city, two cathedrals. And every Friday, we used to always go and have fish and chips. It's just the way it was. Lovely thick batter and the like white flaky fish and Yeah, I mean, it warmed you up. I mean, that was a big part of it too.
On Kangaroo Island off the South Australian coast, the chippy is called Fish, run by expatriate English chef Sue Pearson, who escaped a large upmarket restaurant in London for Australia's blue skies. The tradition of making good fish and chips learned in the Ivy restaurant and from her home in Liverpool.
Just plain flour into the bowl, make a well into the centre. I mean, I use this Cooper's Stout, which is a strong beer.
Same as South Australian, yeah.
Absolutely. And now I'm going to start incorporating some water in there. And if you go small amounts at a time, because you've got to keep getting the lumps out.
Oh, it turns a really lovely brownie colour too, doesn't it?
Oh, wait till you see it coat the fish.
Ooh. Smells wonderfully yeasty
to change
too.
Arms after a bit as well.
Your arms are looking great, Sue. Yeah, obviously, it's a good workout.
All right, now some yeast and then some salt. Then you leave it for sort of an hour or an hour and a half in a warm spot, and then that will sit lovely on the fish and fry up beautifully.
Oh,
for the show.
For the chips, the best potato is one with a low moisture content. They're cooked twice in oil to make them extra crispy.
Look at those little beauties.
Wow, that batter's really come alive, Sue.
It sure has. It's a living thing, isn't it? We're going to just lightly coat this flathead. Once you cook it, it's beautiful and flaky. And now I'm scraping the excess batter off, because that way it's not going to be too thick and it's not going to be oily and greasy. It won't retain it.
Cooking in what sort of oil?
Canola oil.
Gee, it really puffs up in the heat too, doesn't it?
Sure does, yeah. All right, so.
So how long do you cook fish for?
A lot less than a lot of people do cook it for. It's beautiful, fresh fish. I'm going to have this in here no more than 3 minutes. All right, that's just about there. Ooh.
A good batter, you should be able to hear.
There it is.
That fish. Perfect.
Well, you certainly don't have a view like this in England eating fish and chips.
No.
Were once essential fare for the English hunting set. Their pastry sturdy enough to survive a morning's horse ride.
Now put a pork pie in your saddlebag and off you went. And,
right. And half and a day's riding, you wouldn't budge that pastry.
Exactly.
Sue and George Patchett missed good English pork pies so much when they came to Australia that Sue started making them at home. They were a hit with friends and a local deli started stocking them. From there, the word spread, and she moved into a factory now run by her son, Dan, after first securing a good traditional recipe from a winning pie maker in Yorkshire.
So it's important to get those traditions absolutely right.
Oh, yes, it's very important, particularly for the pastry. Mm. And, I mean, a pork pie may seem very simple, but in fact, if you don't get it right, it's filthy.
Filthy?
Aided by equipment from early last century, the hot water crust is made as it always has been, though with less fat in the mix than back in England.
And we just decided that, you know, enough's fat's enough fat, so we have cut back a little bit on the fat.
And how much fat is there in a pork pie?
Not telling.
Okay.
I mean, you can't pretend it's not a fattening thing. It is. But, you know, if you have one occasionally, little of what you fancy does you good.
In England, the local pub is as regular a stop as the local shops. One of the attractions is that you can eat as well as drink. Ploughman's lunch and pork pies eaten cold are always on the menu.
It's never eaten on its own. It's always a mustard Coleman's, which is, I think, one of the best. It's a very hot mustard from Norwich. And...
Nice.
Very good.
Well, yeah. It's great blotting paper pork pie.
Oh, yeah.
Good luck.
Good luck. Cheers.
Chef Jeremy Strode grew up in Wiltshire in England's West Country, in a family that he says were not renowned for their gastronomic brilliance. He started cooking in order to eat better, eventually coming to Australia with his wife Jane, also a chef, and starting Bistrode in Sydney's Surrey Hills.
We always had a jar of something pickled in the fridge
yeah.
when we were young.
What, to go and snack on?
Yes, exactly. I think it's something very quintessentially English. It's retaining that original flavour and integrity, but it's extending its life at the same time, which is what makes pickling so unique. So it's just equal amounts of water, white wine vinegar, sugar, and for this particular fish recipe, we've got some bay leaf and thyme, fennel seed, and yellow mustard seed. We just need to boil that. So we just leave that to cool down, ready to put the fish in. So today we're going to use King George whiting. We take the tail in first, roll it up. So we need the stick. Sometimes, this is the thing about King George, the skin's a little bit tougher than some whiting. There you go. Pop them in the pickle, which is now cold, for at least 24 hours. So 2 days is good.
Mm.
And just let them sit in the fridge. The sugar and the vinegar will cure the fish and it tastes cooked.
And tenderise it as well?
Tenderise it a little bit as well.
For the roll mop dressing, Jeremy mixes an egg yolk, a dash of white wine vinegar, a little seeded mustard, and then a 50-50 mix of olive oil and extra virgin olive oil, and whisks it until it emulsifies.
Just add that slowly, as you would for a mayonnaise. And a dash of cream. And that's it, ready to assemble. So the fish sits on the beetroot. Quintessential salad leaf is watercress, isn't it? We do that.
Yeah,
with
it's lovely.
It's on everything.
But look at that.
Some dressing. That's it. That's our pickled whiting with beetroot relish and watercress.
So, Jeremy, this is English summer for you.
Oh, it's an Australian summer.
An Australian summer. What a great culinary ode to home.
Thank you.
Depending on where you're from in the UK, you'll call afternoon tea or high tea. High tea is used in the north and it usually means an early hearty dinner. In the south, it's a lot more dainty. And if you're asked for tea, you'll know what time to arrive.
4 o'clock.
4 o'clock. And every English person knows.
Oh, yes, they should. Mm-hmm. They should. If they don't, then they've been badly brought up.
The oracle of good taste is journalist Daphne Guinness, who grew up in London and learnt the intricate rules associated with afternoon tea.
Before until five, to be very correct, it can go on till 5:30 and maybe tea towards six.
Mm.
Maybe. By then you shouldn't be anywhere near the tea table. No, honestly, this is very strict.
Mm.
You want to have something rather sort of jolly, conversation. Not genteel.
Mm.
Gossip. It's okay for gossip.
Mm.
It's very pleasant. It's very civilised.
Lovely. And what about the food that goes with it?
Well, I'm all for cucumber sandwiches. It's refreshing.
Mm.
It's got a nice refreshing sort of thing to the mouth. And you need them to be small.
Mm.
And you need them to be no crusts. And you need your cakes to be tiny.
Now, shall I pour you some tea?
That would be divine.
Now, it's milk in... Second.
Absolutely. Tea first, milking
right.
after.
Okay. And tea always made with leaf tea?
Yes, always leaf. Never a tea bag in sight.
No.
Thank you.
Do you? No fingers?
Oh, may. How could you even mention it?
No, well, I just thought I'd ask.
No, I'm glad you asked because no, absolutely
no.
not.
Mm.
You just do. You pick it up like that. Now, I say that because we're sitting at the table.
Yes.
Oh, gosh, this is good. I feel a different person having that. I really do. Tea is fabulous. A lot of people do this.
Oh.
I don't approve of this at the table.
It's quite civilised. It makes you behave in a civilised manner, doesn't it?
Yes, it does. Yeah. It does. It does. It brings out the best in people, I always say.
That's very nice. In every English village, the butcher shop is the nerve centre of life. Some people come every day to buy their meat that's the centrepiece of most meals. Why do the Brits call them bangers?
Because there used to be that much fat in them that when they burst, they exploded.
Oh, my.
When you cooked them up.
Really?
And that's when, in the old days, you used to prick the sausage, and that was always to release the fat, whereas nowadays they're lean. If you prick a sausage today, you're just losing your juices.
Robert Boyle is a little slice of the old country in suburban Melbourne. He makes sausages to the original recipes, including black pudding.
If you go back 100 years or more, every village or every small village had their own unique sausage. You had Cambridge had their own sausage, Oxfordshire, Cumberland, very, very famous sausage, Lincolnshire, very famous all over the world now.
And what is gammon?
Gammon is what Australians would know as ham steak, but it's the original ham steak made from the leg of bacon. And you can have it with your pineapple and your chips, or you can do it in the roast or the joint.
Pineapple and chips.
Yeah, you could have your chips. Chips and mushy peas and gammon. One of my biggest selling ranges is black pudding. Now, black pudding, every old culture makes a black pudding.
It's a blood sausage, isn't it?
It's a blood sausage. It's made from the pig's blood. Mm-hmm. And it's made with barley, oatmeal, onions and spices and pork fat and a few herbs. Absolutely beautiful. Nectar of the gods. There we go. And we're using the traditional ox runner here.
So it's an old tradition.
It's just one of the most favourite things in the British cuisine. Absolutely love it. Everybody loves it. And there's your traditional horseshoes, and they will go into a boiler for about 40 minutes, come out, and then we hang them for a couple of days to dry, and then off out for sale.
Beautiful.
Roast beef with Yorkshire pudding is the big show-off dish on many British tables and restaurants. And there's no better exponent of the country's top dish than a Yorkshireman. Award-winning chef Sean Connolly now has two restaurants he presides over in Sydney. The newest, Sean's Kitchen, is a combination of British and Spanish cuisine.
Sean, amongst English classic dishes, roast beef and Yorkshire pudding has to be, like, top of the tree.
It's the classic dish, isn't it? We're well known for roast beef all over the world, and Yorkshire pudding's the perfect match with it.
So you start with a baking pan on the stovetop?
Yeah, just to warm it up and get the oil hot, and then I'll just put the vegetables in so they all cover and they kind of slightly cook a little bit. This is a boneless rib of beef. It could be known as a Scotch fillet. I make a flour and mustard mix first to create a crust around the beef. We've got 2 tablespoons of flour and 2 teaspoons of King's mustard.
And what, you like to seal the meat on the stove top?
We're going to seal the meat, so I'm just going to drop it in now. And keep seasoning as well, put some salt in it. There you go.
Very nice.
Just going to stir it with a little bit of rosemary. It takes on a lot of flavour. And then we're just going to put some fresh thyme in with the vegetables.
Now, what's the rule of thumb on cooking time?
It's probably, I give it about an hour at 200 per kilo. So that's probably about 2 kilos, so 2 hours.
For the famous Yorkshire pudding, Sean whisks eggs with full cream milk, and then adds that mix into flour that's been sifted with baking powder and salt.
Oh, it's going to be quite a runny mix, eh?
It is, yeah. It's a little bit like pouring cream.
Mm-hmm.
And then we put that in the fridge for an hour.
So you heat the pans?
Get the pans nice and hot. I've also got some hot beef dripping here as well. It's very hot, this. You've got to be careful. Mm.
Ooh!
See it just bubbling underneath.
Oh, that's great fun, isn't it?
There you go. So about 15 to 20 minutes, depends on the oven. You're not allowed to look in the oven because in case they deflect.
Ah,
so
right.
It's very, yeah, keep the door closed. Yeah.
Okay.
So a good thick slice shot.
Yeah, that's right.
Oh, look at that little sauce holder. Oh. Look at that.
Just crack it open, just the knife.
Ooh. Mmm. That's yummy.
It's good, isn't it?
Oh, every day should be Sunday.
I wish. Yeah.
No English meal is ever truly finished until you've had dessert, and some of them go back centuries. Fruit pies and fools, trifle and plumery, and puddings, winter and summer. Matt, tell me about summer pudding and why it's special to you.
Oh, it's just the essence of warm summer days when you've got the height of the berries and you can smell them, you know, it's something you should actually be doing, you know, you should actually be making it. It's just, it's homely. Okay, so we're going to make this, the sauce now, okay? Mm-hmm. Which is basically fresh fruit of whatever we got at the time. So I've got some strawberries, some raspberries, some beautiful mulberries. They're going to help add us some really, really beautiful colour. And then what we're going to do is we're going to add some of this stock syrup that we made before, which is just simply equal quantities of water and sugar. We're going to add a sprig of mint just to help sort of freshen it up. So that's going to go onto the stove. And we're going to bring that up to the boil and let that simmer until the fruit's all nice and soft.
That looks fantastic.
Yeah, I reckon we're pretty close there. So now I reckon we're ready to sort of pass it off. So we're just going to push that fruit in, mate, like that. And again, all that pulp of that fruit coming out, which will help thicken that up really nicely. Okay.
Ooh, that looks so rich.
That's us.
Beautiful.
That's our first stage. So I'm just going to put that over. That's what's going to give us sort of real nice bright red. Do need to soak this bread. The worst thing in a summer pudding is when you go through the bread and they're still in the middle of it, it's still white.
Oh.
No, it's got to be saturated. Mm-hmm. Saturated, okay? It has to be. What we do, let that sit for another couple of minutes while we sort of get the stewed fruit on the go. So this is the leftover coulis that we made. So we're just going to put this sauce back on the stove. And then we can add all this fruit. Blueberries as well. You see, in traditional recipes, they'll say, like, you know, stew it for, like, about half an hour. So all that fruit gets really, really soft. But I just think it just loses so much of its texture. You know, you still want to actually get it.
So this would be, what, 3 or 4 minutes?
Yeah, that's exactly what it is, yeah. And that...
God, that looks so good.
...is our filling ready to go. So...
It's so simple, isn't it?
First layer of bread goes in.
Mm-hmm.
And then what we're gonna do is top it up with a bit of this fruit. Pack it all in. Now we're gonna top it back up with another slice of bread. So that's how easy it is to assemble it.
Wow.
Pretty simple, huh?
Very simple.
We've gotta put it in the fridge, we've gotta let it set up a bit.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, it would take at least, you know, 3 to 4 hours, you know, overnight you can get away with.
Mm.
But yeah, she's definitely gonna firm up.
Moment of truth.
Here we go. Okay,
ooh.
Yes. It worked.
Look at that.
And all we're going to do is got some of that syrup we had left over from the cooking. We're just going to spoon that over.
Oh, look at that.
All right, so we'll put a dollop of cream on top. And that's nice and rich. That's a 45% there. And then arrange a couple of raspberries. Someone gets a mulberry. And then someone gets a strawberry.
Oh.
Simple.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
Mmm.
Mmm. There's going to be a tartness through there, huh?
Wow, it's so nice.
Mm. It's a day of summer, isn't it?
Mm.
It really is. It's an absolute perfect day of summer.
Perfect.
On our next safari, the brilliant colour and delicious flavours of African food, with some of the great dishes and wonderful traditions from Ethiopia, Senegal, Mombasa and Nigeria.
Cool. Cheers, my dear.
Thank you, Dora.
Should we do that?
No, sure.
Oh, well.
That's a frightful thing to make me do.
Oh dear!
You made me complete.
Oh dear! I am sorry.
Did you say cheers first, or did I?
I don't think I said cheers.
Did I say cheers?
Would you have said cheers?
No, I wouldn't.
I feel like I'm in a comedy
in Australia.